Hi, everyone, and welcome to this Holy Thursday worship service. We're still all in the midst of something very challenging and brand new. And tonight, I have adapted this service, I feel, to be more relatable to you under these circumstances of not being together and doing the familiar things such as hand washing and receiving Holy Communion. But I remind you that because of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and this week of Passion, that we are always in communion with God, with Christ, and with each other. So I pray as we go forward on this service that we are able to focus on two other ideas. One, of Jesus' celebration of the Passover, and the second, of the greatest commandment that he spoke that night at the Passover meal. To love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and spirit, and then to love our neighbors as ourselves. And during this time in our world, we have that opportunity. By not doing things instead of doing things, we are loving others. So I pray that you receive this service in that spirit. At the conclusion of this service, you will be able to look at the bulletin, which will be included. And for Good Friday, tomorrow evening, we've been able to resurrect last year's Colors of Grace service that was given to us by the choir here in White Sulphur Springs. And I hope you will find that meditative, reflective, and encouraging of you on Good Friday as Jesus completes his journey to crucifixion.
call to worship is a reading from Exodus 12. This text follows the prediction of the final plague in Egypt. It comes right before the people leave Egypt. These words become important for the celebration of the Passover meal. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning, you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance."
Jesus invites us to the Seder table. Even though he sensed his death was near and darkness was to come upon him, Jesus chose not to seclude himself, but rather to celebrate what God had done in the past for his people. He chose to be close to his friends around the table. He chose to be close to those whom he loved right to the end. The roots of Holy Communion are set within this tradition of the Passover Seder. The Passover Seder was commanded by God over 3,000 years ago. And the purpose of the Seder is to praise God through remembering God's faithfulness to the Israelites as they were in bondage as slaves in Egypt, and the passing over of the angel of death as the blood of the Paschal Lamb was put on their doorposts. Each element of the Passover plate is a symbol of this heritage. The Kiddush cup of wine is the fruit of the vine given by God and symbolizes the sanctification of the people. We raise the cup in praise of God's faithfulness. Matzah, unleavened bread, is a symbolic representation of the affliction. This matzah, unleavened bread, was eaten by the exiles, and this bread is raised in acknowledgement of God's provision. The shank bone is a symbol of the slaughter of the paschal or sacrificial lamb at the temple. the bitter herbs, we use horseradish, is a sign of the bitterness of bondage and slavery experienced by the Israelites. And the parsley and the salt water are signs of the tears shed by those in bondage. The haroset, apples, cinnamon, and nuts, are symbolic of the mortar used by the enslaved Israelites as they made bricks for the Egyptians. But the hard-boiled egg is a symbol of the strength of Israel. See, as an egg is boiled, it becomes harder and stronger. In the same way, the Israelites became stronger as they were challenged. The words and foods, smells and traditions are the same ones uttered today and displayed in a careful order. Jesus tells them and us that the Israelites will be delivered, but a more tragic event, the bondage of sin, will also be liberated. So as Jesus ate this Passover meal, there came a time where he took the bread and the cup, symbolizing his body and blood, offered them to God. He broke the bread, drank from the cup, and invited others to experience his liberation and ours from sin. Jesus then gave thanks to God and passed the cup and the bread, symbolizing to everyone at the table his gift for their salvation. We too participate in the heritage of remembering the acts and works of God and the bittersweetness of the death of Christ. In this simple meal, we are reminded that Jesus declares how salvation comes, not by our striving, but only through God's grace, not as a human project, but as a divine gift. Join me now in the prayer of confession. Lord, we confess that we are sometimes blind to the needs of people right in front of us. Sometimes we see what we can do for others, but ignore them with the empty self-assurance that we are too busy or too tired or that it's not our job to serve. Sometimes we are also blind to our own needs and the ways people serve us. Forgive our selfishness and inspire in us the sacrificial love of Christ. May we hear his commandment anew and love others as God loves us. Amen.
Meals at the feet of his friends.
Practices. These words are key for the church in the practice of communion. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also, after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." As Jesus moves closer to the cross in John's Gospel, this passage offers a key image of Jesus' example of serving others in love. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin, began to wash the disciples' feet, and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash, except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was going to betray him. For this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set for you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." May the Lord add his blessing to the reading and understanding of his word.
Oh,
tonight, we gather to remember and celebrate the last Passover meal Jesus ate on this earth. Jesus knew that. And he tried to tell his disciples several times, but they were just too seduced with his teachings and miracles. They were only able to hear what they wanted to hear. They were so carried away with holiday preparations that they even began to argue who was the greatest at the table. But for Jesus, he knew. He knew that his time with them was running out and that this gathering in that upper room was very special. It was a holy place in time. Jesus was very aware that these were his last hours. Too many times I've been in the presence of people that knew they were in their last hours. And there's something that we all have in common at these times. There's a sense of urgency that somehow we've got to get everything in. We need to share all that needs to be shared. We need to listen to everyone who needs to speak. And we need to be quiet to hear the silence. See, often we don't really need words. But for some people, the last words and instructions usually all boil down to the same thing. They're in one way or another expressions of love and care between the person dying and the living. Again, it's a holy space, a sacred space. It was one that I used to pray a lot and tremble when I entered into the rooms, but now I know how special it is. Now I know what a treasure it is. And now I know what it feels like to share pure love and presence. And being included at that very meaningful time is a real blessing. Jesus, while in that situation with his disciples that they were clueless to, said some very important words. It's that night, at that Passover Seder, that he said, I give you the greatest commandment. Love one another as God has loved us. And love your neighbor as yourself. That word love in our culture gets thrown around so easily anymore. And it has different meanings and different levels of intensity. We say that we love to do this or that we love certain vacation spots and favorite foods, and some of us love to shop or play with our dogs and our animals, and yet we love our children. You hear someone say, maybe for the first time, that they love their spouse. Maybe. For the first time. You see, real love, God's kind of love, God's kind of unconditional sacrificial love is a great motivator. Love can lead us to do tasks that we would never even think of or ordinarily do. Caregiving a parent or a very sick animal takes you to those places. And because of who we are, we do a lot of things that we wouldn't consider doing because of love. Jesus calls us to a kind of action in our love. He does not call us to the touchy-feely, mushy kind of love. He calls us to a response and action. And that kind of love compels us to do a lot of things for a lot of people we probably don't really want to do. And we're called to that, to share in that blessing of love for only one reason. Because God loves us. God loves us so much, He sent His only Son to die for our sins. Doesn't it seem like we should respond? Jesus said we're to love one another as I have loved you. So how did Jesus love those disciples? By caring for them, by teaching them, by being with them. Jesus does not shake a finger and condemn them. He invites them. Jesus got on his knees and washed their feet to give them a demonstration of servant love. Jesus was God incarnate, who became a man and came to live among us and teach us this very same kind of love, the kind that he gave his life for our salvation. And why did God do that? Why did God send His Son to the cross to be brutalized and die a horrible death? Because God loves us. God's love in and through Jesus was sacrificial, painfully physical and emotional, yet unconditional, unmerited, and impossible for us to fully reciprocate. Yet even today, especially today, Jesus calls us to love one another as I have loved you. See, Jesus loves us by being obedient to God's will and to God's mission. Jesus, our Lord, became God's sacrificial lamb, even unto his death. Why would Jesus willingly consent and participate to be a sacrifice? Because it was God's will, and God loves us. Jesus also told us to love our neighbor. And you know, there's a saying about good fences make good neighbors. And people like that because it has a sense of division, that we only have to go so far. Be polite, hi, and goodbye, but don't get too involved. That's not the kind of love that Jesus is talking about. It's not easy to love others, and sometimes people reject you. But Jesus, through his actions of his servant love to God, shows us to get over that, doesn't he? He tells us that we can look past our biases and our little inconveniences, our judgments, even our personal hurts and pains, and love others anyway. And why should we do that? Because God loves us. Jesus also talked about love when he said, love your enemy. Now here's a tough one. It's very hard to act in love towards someone who has hurt you or was a threat to your well-being. But it certainly can be done. It's very difficult, but with God's help, in our decision to do so, we can, because Jesus demonstrated that very kind of love. Jesus did not resist when he was arrested. He didn't resist when he was being beaten. And Jesus also sat at the same Passover dinner with his betrayer at his side. Jesus do there? Because he knew what his mission was for God, and that God loved him and loved us. That phrase, love others as I have loved you, seems just so overwhelming to me and so difficult that I could love anything as much as Jesus has loved us. But yet, that's what we're called to. We're called to put aside our egos and to serve any and everyone that we can. Now, we're not washing people's feet tonight, but there's a lot of ways that we can be humble and care for others. I have to wonder how many of us would really be willing to serve an enemy, to physically stoop below them and touch them in humility, to show love and care despite our hurt feelings. How willing are we really to put aside our pride and our self-motivations and become humbly vulnerable to others, even those that are still sniping at our throats? Can we be like Jesus? Because he was willing to do that. But clearly, even Jesus knew that we humanly can't do this on our own. And if you've lived past the age of 5, you also realize that there's so much in our lives that we can't do by ourselves because of our human nature. We need to have the love of Christ to take us over those humps of pride and ego and need for vengeance and revenge. So we need to be like Jesus and bless others purely and only because God loves us. So when we take our emotions and our needs out of those scenarios, we can act in that kind of love that God calls us to do, because all things are possible with God. There are a lot of amazing things God has done for us. The birth of Christ, the servant journey of Christ to the cross, Christ's passion of love for God and obedience to God's will, and of course that gift of salvation purchased with Christ's body and blood. Holy Thursday, it's another time where we remember Jesus ate with his enemies, but he also surrendered. He walked a life of love, and he calls us to do the same thing, even and perhaps especially when times are tough, people are mean, and when life just isn't going our way. We're still called to rise above it, to love as Christ loved us. As we prepare for Good Friday, a day that's not so good, but a day that truly has determined our faith and our fate as disciples of Christ, let us remember these words. Because God so loved the world, he sacrificed his only Son, that whosoever believes in him will have eternal life. Because that's how much God loves you. Amen.
Amen.
Would you pray with me, please? Almighty God, we gather as the church in new and different ways. Lord, we have fears and threats around us in this world right now. But yet, our praise of you, our recognition of your great gifts to us continue. We gather in an empty church, Lord, but we know that we are not alone, that you are with us, and that the faithful will be together in spirit. And tonight, as we remember that great Seder dinner, that Passover meal, where Jesus himself reflected upon your great works, let us reflect on those and on even more, on the humility of Christ, the passion of his love for us, that he would allow himself to be arrested and surrender to your will. Lord, as the days ahead on this holy week go forward, help us to continue to journey with Christ, to not be distracted by the sins and problems of this world, but to remember the one who gave his life for us, who while among us, taught us how to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.